Welcome to AHR's IAS Institute. In this video, we are covering current affairs for 1st to 15th July, and the topic which we are covering, the main heading which we are covering, is international affairs. So for the first 15 days of July 2020, all international affairs related news items of relevance for the examination which have come up in the Hindu newspaper have been picked up. This is our index. We have two subcategorization. One is international news. You can see the headlines are provided here with even the keywords underlined. So anything related to this, if it comes up, you should be able to answer. So that's the idea. After preparing for this content, you should be able to know anything on national security law and as such. So these words should ring a bell. That's the idea. And you should have all the background information. And the second section which we are covering is international organizations too, which are in news, like World Health Organization and Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, etc. So let's begin. The first news item which we have is China uses national security law to censor internet in Hong Kong. So first of all, you should know about Hong Kong. Hong Kong was basically a colony of Britishers, and Britishers ruled it for 150 years, and finally they handed it over to China in July 1997. And China being a communist country, when Britain handed it back to China in 1997, it ensured that China would let Hong Kong stay and move towards the path of democracy. So based on such conditions, China was given Hong Kong, and it had elections held also. Hong Kong had its first elections held the next year in 1998. But then gradually China tried to control the region of Hong Kong in 2002 itself. You can see 4 years later after the first elections, it proposed this controversial law similar to the national security law presently, an anti-subversion law. But then there were protests, more than 5 lakh people marched against this bill, and it had to be scrapped in 2003. And after this, we have many such instances, like in 2010, again there were protests in Hong Kong when changes were made to electoral laws, which were against democratic provisions. Then in 2014, again an umbrella movement began in Hong Kong, which persisted for 79 days, and demands were for greater transparency in elections. So if we wanted reforms, moving towards democracy, but what China is trying to do is bringing more control over it. So they're working in opposite direction, the population of Hong Kong and the Chinese government. The chief executive of Hong Kong presently is Carrie Lam. She was appointed in July 2017. She is a pro-Beijing person who is the chief executive of Hong Kong. And the legislature is also filled with pro-Chinese entities, you know, and there are Democrats as well as pro-Chinese people who are members of the Hong Kong legislature. Then in 2019, the Hong Kong legislature introduced an extradition bill. So this extradition bill basically called for extradition of any person who is accused of any crime. He can be extradited to mainland China. So there were widespread protests against this bill, and means person from Hong Kong should be prosecuted and, you know, and convicted within Hong Kong. But this bill was calling for extradition to mainland China. So there were widespread protests which went throughout 2019, and finally the government had to revoke this bill which had been passed. But the protest still continued. The demand was also to bring down Carrie Lam as the CEO, but China did not accept these demands as such. The bill, however, the extradition bill was revoked, but it was too little and very late. So finally China also took stern measures and it passed this national security law on Hong Kong. And this law has been passed by the Chinese parliament. And using this law, the news presently is that it has censored internet in Hong Kong. So you can see this national security law passed by Chinese parliament on Hong Kong it was actually on 30th June 2020 that it was passed. It targets subversion, secession, terrorism and collusion with foreign forces. So these are the four aspects which are targeted under the national security law. So basically you can see here, each one of these categories has also been detailed out. Like secession means trying to split from the country, from mainland China. So any offenses related to secession. Subversion means damaging facilities used by the government. Terrorism means damaging public property again and public facilities. So that is also included in the definition of terrorism. And collusion means colluding with foreign and external forces to endanger national security. So all this will result in the person being prosecuted under this national security law, and China will have control over it. So you can see China has also established its intelligence office in Hong Kong. So you can see. So it is said to be the most radical change in Hong Kong's freedoms and rights since it was handed over by Britain in 1997. Also, China has removed pro-democracy books from the libraries and schools in Hong Kong, and it wants similar obedience online too. So that's why even censoring the internet has been put forth under the national using the provisions of the national security law. It wants even access to the user data. Means internet firms and service providers can be ordered to remove information and the equipment can be seized if they don't comply. Even executives can be hit with fines and up to 1 year in jail if they refuse to comply. So the companies are expected to provide identification records and even assistance in decryption. So that is there. So there are various American technology companies which are there working in Hong Kong, like Facebook, Google, Twitter. So far they have put on hold requests by Hong Kong government or police forces. But what lies ahead, we don't know. And all these requests for surveillance, if they are having such covert surveillance operations undertaken, then city's chief executive, that is Carrie Lam's final approval is required for interception. And if it is less intrusive surveillance, then even the senior police officer can provide permission. So even the police have been given powers here. You can see the national security law provides expanded powers for police, allowing them to raid without warrant. Warrantless raids and surveillance are allowed for some national security investigations. So this is there. So you can see there are provisions for secret trials too. Means cases which trials for which will be held behind closed doors without juries. So it's related to any state secret. So such are the stringent provisions under the national security law. The next is Australia ends Hong Kong extradition treaty. So Australia had an extradition treaty with Hong Kong. Basically, extradition treaty means if there's a criminal who is wanted in one country and is hiding in another country, then if the two countries have extradition treaty, then that person can be extradited. So that's the idea. So what is happening is Australia is saying that we are ending the Hong Kong extradition treaty post the national security law being passed by China, because now if it's extradition to Hong Kong, it's eventually will be actually extradition to China, mainland China. So that's why it has said it is suspending its extradition treaty too. And Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison also announced that if Hong Kong students, graduates and workers in Australia on temporary visa, they will have an opportunity if they want, they can stay and work for extra 5 years and even apply for permanent residency after that. So now Australia says we will be attracting talent from Hong Kong, and because many people, it expects that many people will be looking forward to leaving Hong Kong post Chinese stringent measures in their territory. So Hong Kong applicants would also be prioritized under Australia's global talent scheme and business visa program. Then next is Trump ends Hong Kong special trade status. Hong Kong Autonomy Act passed. Now this is Hong Kong Autonomy Act passed by US Parliament. So you should understand which act is for what. National security law was for Hong Kong by Chinese Parliament. And this is Hong Kong Autonomy Act, which is by USA for Hong Kong. So you can see basically its relation with Hong Kong is determined by it. So US President Donald Trump stripped first of all Hong Kong of its preferential trade treatment. So means because Hong Kong was a semi-autonomous region and it was a financial hub too. So there was a preferential trade treatment between trade agreement between USA and Hong Kong. But now US President Trump says that this is being revoked. There will be no preferential trade with Hong Kong anymore, and also he authorized sanctions on banks in Hong Kong. So he signed this law called Hong Kong Autonomy Act, which authorizes sanctions against Chinese officials and Hong Kong police seen as infringing on the city's autonomy. So those who are infringing on city's autonomy, they would be sanctioned by USA, because and they can be Chinese officials, Hong Kong police, so they'll be sanctioned in the sense. Also banks who are involved that make significant transactions with such people, they will also be sanctioned. So that's what means in USA they would find difficulty in functioning. So that's what this Hong Kong Autonomy Act calls for. It allows sanctions to be imposed. Then next is F1 visa students cannot take all classes online. So this is what USA said, but later it has revoked such provision. So there are foreign students studying in USA. The maximum number of foreign students come from China. Second is India. And now there are thousands of Indians. You can see around, it is mentioned here around 2 lakh, I suppose, Indian students who are studying in USA presently. Here you can see at least 2 lakh Indian students in USA. It's the second largest source of foreign students after China. So when so many students are there, foreign students studying there, so they actually, not all of them, but those who are, say, on non-academic and vocational students like F1 and M1 students. So if such visa holders are studying in USA presently, and the institutions, universities have announced they will take only online classes in the autumn session, then they will not be allowed, these students will not be allowed to remain in US. So they lose their immigration status. So this is what the Department of Homeland Security rule announced on 6 July called for. So if they are attending online classes, they cannot stay in US anymore. So due to COVID-19, number of universities are planning to shift all their classes online for the autumn fall semester. So this semester starts normally in September, and there are at least 2 lakh Indian students also there. And this actually is going to affect them. And even the universities have protested against it, like Harvard University, MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. They have said that they have filed a lawsuit against the Donald Trump administration over such a directive. So if foreign students on their of their visas, they'll be stripped of their visas if their coursework was entirely online. So they also said that in the judiciary, they said MIT, Harvard, they said that these are efforts to pressurize universities into reopening and abandoning the cautious approach which they are taking in context of COVID-19. But then when the case came before the court, the US government has said in the court that it has rescinded its policy on not allowing them to stay in USA. So now it is actually a lawsuit which has seen MIT and Harvard being favored against the Department of Homeland Security and IC, which is, you can see, Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency of USA. So this is there. So also, you should know that a little time earlier, US President Donald Trump had suspended H-1B visas also for throughout the end of 2020. So just a few weeks after this, now this announcement has also been made that such students who are taking all classes online, vocational students, they'll not be allowed to study in USA anymore. They will not have the visa status, which immigration status which they have presently. So this is there. So then, because the case was filed before the court, the Trump administration made it clear that this provision has been rescinded now, so it will not no longer be applicable. So it was actually in March 2020 itself, Trump administration permitted international students because of COVID-19 that they can take online classes. So academic students are allowed, but new F1 visa students, whether they will be issued such visas if they are not yet enrolled for the educational programs or not, means it will be entire courses online. So those who enroll now, will they get the same F1 visa status or not? That is not clear. Presently who are there will be getting. So such are the stringent provisions being used against foreigners coming into USA. So even students are being targeted here, though this provision could not last. So this has been rescinded, but even H-1B visas have been cancelled. So such steps have been taken ahead of the November 2020 presidential elections in USA. Then next is Britain bans Huawei from further future role in 5G network. So Huawei is basically a Chinese telecommunication company, and it already has its presence in Britain too. But now Britain, which had earlier said that it will continue to have Huawei in non-critical aspects of 5G technology, has now said that it would not have any relation with Huawei. It will not allow it to have any future role in 5G network in Britain because of US sanctions. So Britain said it imposed the ban after US sanctions made it impossible to ensure the security of Huawei equipment, because US threatened that it will sever intelligence sharing arrangement with UK because of Huawei equipment being used in Britain. So because it says Huawei equipments could allow Chinese, because it's a Chinese company, so it could allow Chinese government to infiltrate UK networks. So since UK networks would be infiltrated by Chinese government due to Huawei, through Huawei, so US will have no relations with such countries. So similarly, USA has threatened many countries and they have cut all ties and have isolated Huawei basically because it's a Chinese company. So that's there. You can see in January 2020, when US had announced such a measure, at that time British Prime Minister Mr. Johnson had Boris Johnson had sought to balance economic and security pressures by agreeing to give Huawei a limited role in Britain's so-called 5G network. So it had excluded the company from core components of 5G system, but it can be involved. Still, Huawei was given a role to play, and it could be involved up to 35% of the overall project. Because Huawei is also bringing in funding and resources with it. So it wanted economy to flourish too. So Britain had taken such a decision, but now because of US threatening of severing intelligence sharing arrangement with UK, UK had to finally backtrack on its plans to give Huawei any limited role too in 5G technology. So here you can see. So basically, this decision of British Prime Minister is going to affect USA too, affect Britain too, because this announcement means a cumulative delay of 2 to 3 years in 5G rollout in Britain and a cost of up to $2 billion, which has been admitted by the government itself, but says it was essential because of US threats. So here you can see in 2018 also US partnership with AT&T fell through. So Huawei was chucked out of USA. Australia banned Huawei from 5G infrastructure over national security concerns in August 2018. And then even New Zealand, you can see intelligence banned Huawei from 5G rollout. British Telecom also had dropped Huawei from 4G rollout also. So USA has been urging its allies to shun Huawei. So that's what is going on since 2018. You can see even Canada had arrested Huawei financial chief Meng Wanzhou, who is the daughter of Huawei company's owner. So she was also arrested because of US concerns that it is involved in, stealing data basically through its telecom technology and providing it to China. Then next is again US-China relations. This is US rejects Beijing's claim in South China Sea. So this is US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, who has said that US would treat China's pursuit of resources in South China Sea as illegal. So this was the first time that it has clearly stated, because USA has actually been conducting Freedom of the Seas exercises in South China Sea in collaboration with various Southeast Asian nations, and China has actually asserted its claim in South China Sea through its so-called nine dash line. So this is there on maps since 1940s. You can see this is the nine dash line, basically this red line. So this entire region basically is claimed by this red line is claimed by China, and it is building artificial islands here too. So this overlaps with the EEZs, exclusive economic zones, which extend 200 nautical miles from the coast according to UN Convention on Law of the Sea. So these are the EEZs of, you can see, Vietnam, then of Philippines, Brunei, Malaysia. So they actually overlap with the claim of China. So basically, this is the concern, and now USA also clearly states that the such actions of China here is illegal. Why is China interested in this region? Is one that it has resources, and it is also passing through an important trade route. So it has been spending, China has been spending years building military bases on these artificial islands here. So this is there. So you can see even the Scarborough Reef, Spratly Islands here are actually uninhabited archipelagos. They are a group of islands and they are not inhabited, means nobody lives on them. But still, you can see China has asserted itself in this region. Even Chinese claim had been rejected by UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. Its tribunal, UN Class Tribunal, in 2016 had given its decision. It was actually a case which had been filed by Philippines. So the tribunal of UN Class gave its decision in 2016, in which it said that the Chinese claim over this region is illegal. So because that belonged to Philippines basically. So these are the Scarborough Spratly Islands here. You can see the map which goes below here. So this is a Scarborough Shoal, Spratly Islands. So it is said to be belonging to Philippines and not to China. So this was a tribunal ruling 4 years ago now. So it was the fourth anniversary, and this time US Secretary of State has announced that in China, USA also calls Chinese action illegal. But you should also know that USA is actually not part of the UN clause. But it says since China is party to UN clause, then the tribunal's ruling is legally binding on China. But USA itself is not part of UN clause, so it can violate it and it cannot be prosecuted also. So that's the case. So that's what USA has been doing now. It has been coming out of various international organizations. It is leaving international organizations. And it has actually not been part of UN clause only. Here you can see UN clause also had various conferences in which, you know, UN clause 1, 2 and 3 are mentioned here. And at UN clause 3, the UN conference on law of the sea, this UN convention on laws of sea was finalized and signed and ratified, and it has come into effect, but USA has not ratified it even till date. And what it calls for is 200 nautical miles from the baseline, from the shoreline, as the exclusive economic zone of a particular country. But if they are overlapping, if the distance between two countries' waters as such is not 400 nautical miles, that they can be equally divided amongst the two, so then there will be the midline through which the country's exclusive economic zone would be decided. These are the terminologies under UN Convention on Law of the Sea, like territorial water. It extends from baseline here, you can see, till 12 nautical miles. So that is the territorial water. Then you can see contiguous zone, EEZ, up to 200 nautical miles from the baseline. And then beyond that is the high seas. So this is it. Then next is US killing of Iran General Soleimani unlawful, says UN expert. So this is a UN expert, Agnes Callamard, who is UN special reporter on extrajudicial summary or arbitrary executions. She has concluded in her report that the killing of Iran's top general Qasem Soleimani through a US drone strike in Iraq basically was unlawful. It was an arbitrary killing and violated the UN charter. So she'll be presenting her report to the UN Human Rights Council in Geneva. So it's presently the report is her personal decision being released. It's not a UN Human Rights Council report, but this report will go before the council. And you should know about here also that US has withdrawn from UN Human Rights Council also in 2018. So that is there. So this drone strike killing Iranian general took place in January 2020. You should know. So this is about US leaving UN Human Rights Council. So this was at a time when US accused UN Human Rights Council of hypocrisy and bias against Israel. So US had decided to leave the organization. So here you can see the countries which are members, and basically it's a UN organization. It's headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland. And it replaces the UN Commission on Human Rights. So it's a UN Human Rights Council set up in 2006. It has been heavily criticized for having countries with poor human rights records as members. And USA actually joined the council and in 2009, this new Human Rights Council under President Barack Obama. So Bush, President George W. Bush administration had decided to boycott the body, saying that it is no different from its predecessor. But 2009, Barack Obama joined. But now we see President Trump again threatened, and he has finally left the council too in 2018. So it says that the criticism which is there, which was stated by US Ambassador to UN Nikki Haley too, was that the UN Human Rights Council was criticized for its hostility towards Israel and claims that human rights abusers such as China, Cuba, Venezuela, Congo will be elected as members. So such countries continue to become members, and it is biased against Israel. So that hostility towards Israel were the two reasons why USA decided to leave the organization. The next is China-Iran close to reaching trade and military partnership. So China and Iran are now coming together. So you should know Iran is also sanctioned by USA and China is also sanctioned. And now the two countries are coming together and a sweeping economic and security partnership is going to be signed between the two countries. It's a $400 billion long-term agreement in which Chinese investment will come in various sectors in Iran like banking, telecommunication, ports, railways, etc. And China would receive a regular supply of Iranian oil for the next 25 years. So heavily discounted oil would be provided to China. Also, military cooperation between the two countries will be deepened and there will be more joint exercises, training, and China will also offer its GPS to Iran, even build infrastructure for 5G rollout in Iran, develop free trade zones as such. So this will be a major blow to Trump administration because it has been trying to isolate Iran through its maximum pressure policy. So that was after that policy change happened after US President Trump decided to opt out of the nuclear deal, which was reached in 2015. So when the nuclear deal was abandoned by President Trump, which was actually huge efforts put in, and finally after 2 years of grueling negotiations from 2013 to 2015, finally in 2015 this deal was signed between among President Barack Obama of USA, then President Barack Obama, and leaders of six other nations, even the P5 nations, five permanent nations, and European Union was also there. So they signed this deal, the nuclear deal between Iran and these nations, but this has been now opted out from by USA. So President Trump began imposing sanctions against Iran. So in 2018, sanctions were imposed, and then there was time given till 2019, US sanction waivers were given, but that also expired in May 2019. So China actually continues to have oil imported from Iran, but India completely stopped after US waiver also ended. So here you can see India stopped buying Iranian oil in 2019, but China continued, though in smaller quantities. Because Iran is actually one of the world's largest oil producer and exports it too. So it depends. A large source of its revenue comes from these exports. But US sanctions has resulted in these oil exports becoming difficult. So now China coming into a deal with Iran means China itself will get about 75% of its oil. It actually has a huge oil requirement, a fuel requirement. It gets about 75% of its oil from abroad. So it has, so like India actually gets more than 90% oil from abroad. So China, it is 75%. So it's actually China is the world's largest importer of oil. So this deal basically will ensure that China also gets smooth flow of oil. Also, not just this, even Iran and China working together on finalizing the Chabahar port too. So Chabahar port actually was a project been built by India in Iran. So it's an Iranian port, Chabahar port. So the rail line has also to be built from Chabahar port to Zahedan, which is along the border with Afghanistan. Here you can see the map shown. So this is a Chabahar port in Iran. So further we have Zahedan and Zaranj, Telaram. So all these regions, they had to be connected. So basically what India wanted was through water route, it can reach Chabahar in Iran and further into Afghanistan. So it can bypass Pakistan and reach Afghanistan through the sea route. So Chabahar port was a crucial point here, which was proposed to be built by India in Iran, and an agreement was signed on this in 2003 actually, but nothing happened, and that is why now we are seeing that Iran has said that it will no longer be working with India on this. It has revoked this deal from India. So this is there. So China is likely to play a role in Chabahar port also now. The deal was signed also, the project was signed in 2016, but this proposed funding, it will require a rail line from Chabahar to Zahedan will also require a funding of $400 million. So delay in money coming in from India means Iran has decided to no longer partner with India, but now it is likely to be partnering with China. So what are the benefits of this Chabahar port in Iran are mentioned that it will be developed by India and it will provide us access to Afghanistan. So even the sea route as such too. So distance between Kandla and Chabahar is just 550 nautical miles. So through that you can see it was expected that various companies, various sectors will get an impetus. They will get a further trade route through Iran into Europe too. But now since India has been removed from this deal, so this opportunity has been lost actually. Then next is Russian mining giant told to pay $2 billion for Arctic spill. So this we have seen earlier also. You should know about it. Norilsk Nickel, which is actually a Russian company, it is the world's largest producer of nickel and palladium. It's controlled by Russia's richest man Vladimir Potanin. So here actually this company was involved in around 21,000 tons of diesel fuel being spilled from its reservoir into the Arctic region. So the reservoir had collapsed in May 2020, and this is near the outside the city of Norilsk in Arctic region. So this has resulted in huge stretch of river and remote tundra region being polluted, and it's appearing as bright red patches even in from space. So this is said to be the one of the worst oil spills in US history. The worst oil spills after the US history oil spill. This is actually oil spill in Russia. So in 1998, even Exxon oil spill, which took place off Alaska, resulted in $5 billion in punitive damages. So now Russia's environment watchdog has made a price on this too. And the damages which have to be paid for this is said to be $2 billion. So here you can see the Arctic region in Russia. So unauthorized dumping took place here, because of which it has resulted in huge pollution of the tundra region too and the water body too. Then next is Rohingya refugees stuck at Bhashanchar Island of Bangladesh. So Bhashanchar Island is actually an uninhabited island which has been built. Houses have been built here by the Bangladesh government to make the Rohingya stay here. Rohingya, it's like a refugee camp. So hundreds of Rohingya refugees on the flood-prone island. The island is actually uninhabited because of various reasons. So one basically important reason is that it is flood-prone. So it is flood-prone means people who are there, they may get stuck. So and they may also, if flooding is severe, then they may even lose their lives. So in such a region too, Bangladesh government made provisions and has settled down Rohingyas. And now these 306 Rohingyas, who are actually Muslims from Myanmar, they have been staying here since April 2020. And they have been, news came forth that they were being trafficked to Malaysia, around 306 Rohingyas. So this resulted in, United Nations also speaking about how there are concerns about these refugee camps. So UN has also spoken about the plight of these refugees, Rohingya Muslim refugees in Bhashanchar Island in Bangladesh, and wants them to be moved to mainland, because Cox Bazar is the main refugee camp in Bangladesh, but now it has become overcrowded. So that is there. So you should know about this too. You can see Bhashanchar Island, which is an uninhabited island in the estuary of Meghna River of Bangladesh. So Ganga and Brahmaputra meet and form Meghna, which flows through Bangladesh. So that's the river. Then next is Hagia Sophia. The 6th century Byzantine monument is being turned into a mosque again. So Hagia Sophia, basically it means holy wisdom. This is a monument in Istanbul in Turkey. Old name of Istanbul is Constantine. So basically it was built by Byzantine Empire in the 6th century. And it is revered presently too, in present day too, both by Orthodox Christians as well as Muslims. And it was originally built here and it was a church. But later it was converted into a mosque. And then when the First World War took place and the Ottoman Empire collapsed after the First World War, even at that time the Turkish secularist government which was formed was under Mustafa Kemal Pasha, and he was called Atatürk, father of Turks as such. So at that time Turkey had decided to form, when a secular government was formed here, it was decided that this Hagia Sophia would neither be a church nor a mosque, but it will be a museum. But now, presently, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan has announced that he'll turn this into a mosque. You can see it was an Eastern Orthodox patriarchal cathedral for about 900 years, an imperial mosque for 482 years, and a museum and a famed tourist spot since 1935. But now it is proposed to be made into a mosque as such. It's also a UNESCO World Heritage Site, you should know. It is one of the most visited monuments in Turkey. Now, Turkish administrative court has cancelled the museum status of this monument too. So, it's no longer a museum. Even its management rights have been transferred from Ministry of Culture to Directorate of Religious Affairs by the Turkish government. So, this is there. In Istanbul, old name Constantinople. So, here is where this mosque lies. So, Hagia Sophia Mosque. Then next is Burkina Faso killings were extrajudicial. So this is Burkina Faso, a landlocked country in West Africa. So here insurgents issues are of a concern. So five countries have come together and have formed G5 Sahel, which is a joint force to tackle security threats. So these five countries involved are Burkina Faso, Mali, Niger, Chad, you can see Chad and here Niger, Chad and Mauritania. So these five countries are come together and formed G5 Sahel or 5G Sahel. So their mission is to counter terrorism, organized cross-border crime and human trafficking. So battalions have been formed here in Burkina Faso. And it is said that the army of Burkina Faso had been involved in killing of these at least 180 men. So it is speculated they were extrajudicially executed by the army. So the authorities actually have waged a war against jihadist insurgency, which is of a concern here since 2015. But then extrajudicial killings of even civilians by army or the terrorists is unacceptable. So here you can see even men from ethnic groups in this region are being targeted by insurgents for recruitment. So this is Boko Haram in the Sahel region, and you can see various organizations like Al Qaeda, Islamic State, Boko Haram function here. Boko Haram is basically in Chad region. So here you can see in 2014 Boko Haram had kidnapped 276 schoolgirls, and later you can see now they have been proposed to be released also gradually. 82 schoolgirls will be released. So this is so they had kidnapped the girls and then some of them have been released. So to fight against such terrorist insurgent groups, the grouping G5 Sahel has been formed. Then we come to international organization related news. The first one is World Health Organization sets up independent panel to probe its virus response. The World Health Organization has been severely criticized by United Nations for its handling of the pandemic, and basically been lenient towards China. So US is actually one of the largest owner, largest donor. It's a top donor to World Health Organization. And now when it is withdrawing from the organization, US has decided to withdraw from even World Health Organization. So all international organizations are being left by USA, it seems. So this has resulted in World Health Organization deciding that it will form independent panels to look into its response to COVID-19 and critically analyze it. So here you can see this is an independent panel headed by former New Zealand Prime Minister Helen Clark and former Liberian President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. So World Health Organization Chief Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, he said that the report as such by this independent panel will be sent to the United Nations. So this has been announced. You can see even World Health Organization's response to not just COVID-19 but earlier pandemic also, earlier disease, that is the Ebola outbreak of 2014, was also highly criticized, because you can see pandemic resulted in various deaths, which has been seen in the case of COVID-19 too. And this is the same news. Trump has decided to withdraw US from World Health Organization. So So this is there. It will be depriving World Health Organization of its top funding source too. It's, you can see, it is $400 million annual US contribution, which had already been threatened to be suspended. And now it has not just suspended the funding, but also withdrawn completely from the organization. So this complete withdrawal will take place over a year, that is by July 6, 2021. And the last news is AIIB, that is Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, releases $50 million to L&T Infra Finance. So L&T Infrastructure Finance Company Limited of India, which is wholly owned subsidiary of L&T Finance Holdings, has received first tranche of $50 million of the $100 million external commercial borrowing loan from AIIB. So this has been given as a loan. So first tranche of $50 million has been accepted. So this is said to be AIIB's, that is Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, its first loan to a non-banking financial company in India. So this will be used for on lending, means the company AIIB is providing this money to L&T Finance Holdings, and what L&T would do, it will take this loan and will set up on lend to large to mid-scale wind and solar power infrastructure projects in the country. So that is what it has stated. So this basically what you should know is about AIIB. It was set up in 2015, and you can see the founding members. China is the largest shareholder here. So it's basically to address Asia's infrastructure gap. So here you can see. So 27 countries had applied to join the bank, and later further members were also accepted. So this is Asian Development Bank. And this here you can see regarding contributions as such and comparison being done, Asian Development Bank and AIIB. So in terms of capital, you can see AIIB reached $100 million target, but it's basically, you can see, it's still a long way to go compared to Asian Development Bank, that is for the entire Asian continent. And members also have not still, you can see, are more. So more countries have joined AIIB. So here you can see. So AIIB is Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, and another one is New Development Bank, which is also having China as a major stakeholder, and that is also known as BRICS Bank, because it has four nations here: Brazil, Russia, India, five nations: Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. So BRICS Bank is also planned. So this is it. So that is it. Thank you.